Hey everyone, this is Michael with Christopher Street Tours. On today's episode of Queer History, we're going to be talking about the Stonewall Riots, the famous uprising that happened in 1969, often known as the spark of the modern gay rights movement. Since there is so much information to share about this particular moment in history, I'm going to be breaking this up into a three-part series. And in this video, I'll be talking about pre-Stonewall and the factors that led to the uprising in 1969. Before we begin, it is important to say that LGBT history did not start at Stonewall, although a lot of people do refer to it as the birthplace of the modern gay rights movement. There are hundreds of years of advocacy and activism before Stonewall, but Stonewall changed the course of history in some very specific ways that we'll talk about later in the third part of this series. The Stonewall riots occurred at the Stonewall Inn, located at 51 and 53 Christopher Street, located in New York City's Greenwich Village. Coincidentally, this street is also where Christopher Street Tours got its name. Before the Stonewall Inn was the gay bar that we know it to be today, it was known as Bonnie's Stonewall Inn, a restaurant and bar which originated in 1934. Before this, the building actually operated as horse stables, which held the famously black-painted horses that would deliver goods to Saks Fifth Avenue department store. Unfortunately, there was a devastating fire that occurred in 1966, which ended up closing Bonnie's Stonewall Inn and left the building up for demolition. However, the next year in 1967, the Genovese Mafia family came in and decided to rent out the bar. The Mafia family decided to slap a coat of black paint on the inside, covering the scorched wood and all the windows, and open it up for business as the Stonewall Inn, the gay bar. This may surprise some of you, but Mafia-owned bars were actually pretty common during this time, especially in LGBTQ spaces. Owning and operating a gay bar in 1967 was still technically considered illegal, which meant that the Mafia could charge whatever they wanted, exploiting the patrons of Stonewall and other gay bars by making an extreme profit. The fee to get into Stonewall in the 1960s was about $1 on the weekday and $3 on the weekend. In today's currency, that would be around $8 during the week and $24 on the weekend. In one weekend night, it was common for the Mafia to make upwards of $6,000 in just one night from all the people that were coming to Stonewall, and that doesn't even count for inflation. The police knew what was happening at the bars, but often the Mafia would bribe them with a cut of the profits to just look the other way. Police would still come in regularly to raid the bars, but it was common for them to give the Mafia a heads up, and oftentimes they were just coming to collect their cut of the profits. However, it was possible that LGBTQ folks could be arrested during these raids, or sometimes even worse, having their name published in the newspaper. At this time, having your name published in a newspaper saying that you were at a gay bar and being outed in this way could often lead to losing your apartment, losing your job, or even losing your family and friends. The conditions of the bar itself were also not the best. Oftentimes there was no running water, and when there was running water, the toilets were known to overflow. Despite all of this, the Stonewall Inn was still one of the most popular gay bars in all of New York City. This is because it was one of the only places that all people within the community could go. Stonewall was the first place where everybody within the community could feel welcomed, including women, drag queens, trans folks, and people of color. The Mafia didn't really care what you looked like as long as you could pay to get in. On another note, Stonewall was one of the only places that you could dance, with not only one dance floor, but two, and a jukebox. Despite the raids and the Mafia presence and the not-so-great conditions, the Stonewall Inn was still one of the only places where people could experience a sense of freedom and have a space that was their own. The Stonewall Inn continued operating this way until 1969, the year of the uprising. Times were changing in America for LGBTQ people. There were several articles that year that were published in the Wall Street Journal about the rising militancy of homosexuals. Also that year, the best Tony Award-winning musical was Hair, which had a lot of positive themes and references around homosexuality. At this time, America was at a turning point with activism and advocacy. The civil rights movement had just ended the year prior, and we were at the height of the Vietnam War and Vietnam anti-war protests. America was also in the middle of the second wave of feminism. LGBTQ folks had always been involved in these social movements and had started to wonder when it would be their turn to start building their own movement. The spark of the movement comes on June 28, 1969, the first night of the Stonewall Uprising. To hear more and to learn more about what actually happened during the Stonewall riots themselves, check back next time for our second part in this three-part mini-series. And with that, that concludes this episode of Queer History with Christopher Street Tours. Be sure to subscribe to our channel below and follow us on Facebook and Instagram at Christopher Street Tours for more queer history. Until next time. Christopher Street Tours is an LGBTQ-owned organization. Our mission is to make LGBTQ history accessible and engaging, sharing stories and uplifting voices from those who paved the way before us. For more information and resources, please visit ChristopherStreetTours.com.